Okay, good morning, welcome back. I hope you all had a good break. So I hope so that you guys have taken a look at the assignments. I had, as much as possible, I had adhered to whatever you guys had given me as the group, but whoever were left over, their names have been included in some of those groups where there were less number of people. But still, I feel that one person is left out. Anyway, nobody has gotten back to me, so I don't know. Because every group, 5 and 30 groups, 150 people. But I feel that one name is somewhere repeated or one name has been left out. Something is wrong. This much I was very sure. But I could not figure out of 150 names. It was very difficult for me to go through ek-ek karke. So I have not done it. So people who are affected, they have to come back to me. If they don't come back to me, then I have to take it that there is no problem. As simple as that. Okay. So we were supposed to start on inverters the other day, which are meant for DC to AC conversion. So DC to AC conversion is normally done, you know, with the help of inverter. It can be DC to single phase AC or it can be DC to three phase AC. As I told you the other day, there are two types of inverters, VSI and CSI, current source inverter and voltage source inverter. And voltage source inverters are normally going to be, you know, appearing everywhere. Current source inverters are generally rare. We do not use them very commonly. They are used only in tens of megawatt or at least a few megawatt power rating. Not really at lower levels. Whereas VSIs are used right from a few watts to a few tens of megawatt. Whereas if we want to go for hundreds of megawatt, generally VSIs are not very good because VSIs generally are switched very fast. Let me write the characteristics. Basically, these are going to be having a stiff voltage source which is connected to their DC link. So what I control basically is the way I switch in and switch out the devices, because of which the output voltage is controlled. The current is determined by the load that is connected. So output voltage is controlled, V naught is controlled by switching in and switching out the devices, and frequency is controlled. Both are controlled. But the current is determined by the load impedance, I should say. Right? Whereas if I try to look at the voltage source inverter, the current source inverter, rather in the current source, I'm going to have fairly, I would not say exactly, but stiff value of current, which means it's a steady value of current. So stiff value of current. This is what we are going to have as the input, which is a DC current. So obviously, I can't vary the direction of current on the source side. I'm going to have a large inductance which is going to almost maintain the current direction and magnitude both as constants. So I will not be able to reverse the direction of current in this particular case. And if I try to look at the output, I naught can be controlled, but what is the voltage? That will be Z multiplied by I naught, which will be V naught. So I'm going to have impedance determining what is the voltage. Right? That is not going to be controllable as far as I am concerned. With the help of switching, I can't control it. Right? And because we are normally going to operate the voltage source inverters at pulse width modulated control, PWM control, what we just introduced in the last class. I just introduced the terminology. So pulse width modulation is width of the pulse is modulated. I can have complete 180 degrees as positive pulse, 180 degrees as negative pulse, which is no control. If I try to introduce only about 90 degrees positive pulse, 90 degrees negative pulse, rest of the times it's all dead. The circuit is dead. Then I'm essentially modulating the pulse. So generally, pulse width modulation is very commonly used in this particular case, which means I may have multiple pulses. That is, I can think of in the positive half cycle, I may have a wide pulse in the middle, I may have a little smaller pulse, then I may have very thin pulse, and again I may have somewhat wider pulse and a very thin pulse like this. Similarly, I can make the negative half. I can have a thin pulse, little wider pulse, wide pulse, then something like this. So this is essentially almost emulating. I am not saying exactly, almost emulating a sinusoid. So if I try to look at what is the kind of value I'm going to get, I will probably get a value somewhat like this. Right? This is how it will be. So I can say the width of the pulse is modulated as per the amplitude of the sine wave that I want to get at any instant. This is generally known as sinusoidal pulse width modulation. Wherever I want to modulate the pulses as per the sine wave amplitude. Wherever the amplitude is maximum, I want to have maximum width of the pulse. Wherever the amplitude of the sine wave is minimum, I want to have the minimum width of the pulse. So this is generally known as sinusoidal pulse width modulation, which is very commonly employed in inverters. But this kind of control will really require multiple number of switchings to be done in 180 degree interval itself, which means within 20 milliseconds, I may have 10 or 20 switchings or even more, which means very fast acting devices have to be used. Here, fast-acting devices are used, which means I will need basically IGBT or MOSFET or any other controllable device that can be used in this particular circuit. Whereas, if I try to look at CSI, normally CSI will have the front-end converter to be a controlled rectifier, what we discussed all along initially, and this is connected to a say 3-phase 50 hertz source. Now the controlled rectifier output is connected through a large inductance to the CSI, and CSI also may be made up of thyristors in all probability. So I will have to essentially operate, if it is thyristor based CSI, I'm talking about here thyristor based CSI, which means I have to operate it slowly because thyristors definitely take a little longer as compared to MOSFET or IGBT. And IGBT, I remove the pulse, it will go off. Whereas thyristor, I remove the pulse, it will not go off. I have to definitely have an external circuit, commutation circuit, to make sure that it goes off. But the major advantage is thyristor will be able to handle single-handedly 30 megawatts and so on and so forth. Whereas if I use IGBT or MOSFET, they can handle very, very small power capacity as compared to what the thyristor can handle. So generally, CSIs go hand in hand with thyristors. And because it is thyristors, it will not be fast acting. It will be slow on-off control. I will not be able to really, you know, make it operate at a very, very high frequency. So PWM is not very commonly employed in CSI. Whereas VSI always employs PWM, pulse width modulation, because it can act fast. That will act like a source for modifying the amount of voltage. Here, I can't modify the voltage current that is coming out. If I want to control the current, only way I can control is the controlled rectifier. So invariably, I will modify the source itself. Whereas here, I will not modify the source, because if you look at a normal VSI circuit, it will have a battery or a steady DC voltage that is coming out of a rectifier with the capacitor filter. There will be a big capacitor filter, right? Thousands of microfarads. So what I have is a fixed value of DC, and this will be going out to the VSI, and VSI output is going to the load if I'm talking about a three-phase VSI. Similarly, here, this is the CSI, and this will be going to the load. Right? So hardly ever we use PWM control here, whereas we use all the time, 99.9% of the times we'll be using PWM control. The PWM control essentially allows me to modify, if I just reduce the width of this pulse, reduce this further, obviously I'm going to get less and less amount of RMS value of voltage. So I would be able to adjust the pulse width to get variable voltage. Whereas here, if I want variable current, generally I adjust the alpha, firing angle alpha of the input side converter. So this alpha has to be varied to get variable I, whatever is the current I'm talking about. Whereas here, PWM control is commonly used for output voltage control, V naught control, right? The last but not the least, one more major difference is, because I have VSI always connected along with the capacitor, if you may recall the circuit, we had something like this. This was the DC, and I was showing as though there were two capacitors in series, and I told you that there will be two switches like this, and then I'm going to connect a load like this. This is what we stored as half bridge VSI. By chance, if I turn on both these together, I will have a dead short circuit, which is deadly. We call it a shoot through. Shoot through is deadly in the case of the VSI. Whereas in CSI, because there is a large inductance sitting here, it will not allow rise of current in a big way, in a very short span of time. The impedance that is sitting in between the rectifier and the inverter, that is going to make sure that the current does not rise right away. So you have enough time for the protection to act. If there is a protection circuit, it will be able to act quite well. So CSIs need not be protected against shoot through or short circuit, whereas VSIs have to be protected against shoot through, because VSIs do not have any current limiting component, whereas CSIs have a current limiting component sitting right up front, which is actually our inductance or impedance, I would say, because the inductance will definitely have some inherent resistance as well, right? So most of our discussion will be centering around VSI initially. Maybe one lecture I'll devote to CSI finally, right? Most of our things will be centered around VSI, because VSI has plenty of applications, whereas CSI has mainly a couple of applications. One application typically is high power drives, synchronous motor drive, induction motor drive, which are of tens of megawatt rating. They are normally controlled with the help of a CSI. That is one of the applications. The second application is only HVDC transmission system, high voltage DC transmission system. These are the major two applications of CSI fed drive. One is the drive itself. When I say CSI, automatically drive comes into my mouth. So CSI basically is applied in two things. One is CSI fed drive itself, large capacity motors, The second one is HVDC transmission system, high voltage DC transmission system, right? These are the major two applications of CSI. Whereas you name any other application, it is all VSI. You talk about home inverter, you talk about microwave oven, you talk about CFL, that is compact fluorescent lamps. You talk about induction furnace, induction heating, anything, all of them are generally VSIs, not CSI. Okay? Now let us now go into VSI, voltage source inverters. Yes. So voltage source inverter, let us start with first of all single phase half bridge. We had seen this already in the form of a half bridge DC-DC converter. Only thing is the rectifier portion has to be eliminated. That's all is the difference. So we will have one voltage source, which is VDC. We are going to have normally two capacitors dividing the voltage equally. So this is plus minus, this is plus minus. Say this is VDC by 2, this is also VDC by 2. Now this has one switch here and one more switch here. And we are going to have a load here connected between these two. So let me call this as C1, this as C2, let me call this as S1, this as S2. And the load is connected between, let's say, P and Q. Okay? So when we turn S1 on, I'm going to have essentially the current going like this through the load, through S1. Whereas, if I turn S1 off and then I turn S2 on, I'm going to have a current flowing like this. So obviously, in the load, the current is always alternating. Depending upon at what frequency I turn on and turn off S1 and S2 respectively. And we will do it with respect to half phase symmetry. We don't want positive half to dominate over the negative half or vice versa. We don't want to have any DC component because what we anticipate is that the load should get a pure AC as much as possible. I'm not talking about sinusoidal AC as such. It is pure AC. So I don't want any DC component, which means the positive half and negative half exactly have to be the same or equal to each other. So if I am looking at actually the waveform, when I am going to turn S1 on, maybe I am going to have a voltage like this, which is actually VDC by 2. The positive voltage is going to be plus VDC by 2. And similarly, when I am having, so this is S1 on. S1 is on during this particular interval. And I am going to have S2 on for the next 180 degrees, again S1 on for the next 180 degrees and so on and so forth. Right? And if I look at the current, if it is resistance load, then the current would be exactly the same as voltage. Right? So I should be able to get what is the value of the fundamental voltage under this condition. Right? If I want the fundamental voltage, I can say that AN components will be zero because this is all cosinusoidal component. Half phase symmetry is there. If I try to do the Fourier expansion, the DC value will also be zero. I will not have any DC or average value. So I should say DC component is zero and AN is also zero. So BN I should be able to calculate as 2 by pi. 0 to pi, because even if I integrate from 0 to pi, it is the same. This is minus VDC by 2. So BN is going to be 2 by pi times 0 to pi VDC by 2 multiplied by sine omega t n omega t rather d omega t. So if I want to get the fundamental, which is V1, I should be able to write this as 2 rather VDC by pi multiplied by 0 to pi sine omega t d omega t. If I write the entire Fourier expansion as whatever is the DC component, right, f of DC, and I can say an cos n omega t plus bn sin n omega t, n equal to 1 to infinity, right? Regular definition of Fourier expansion, that's it, right? So this is going to be 2 VDC divided by pi, right? So this is actually the peak of the fundamental. What we get here is the peak of the fundamental. So if I want RMS, I have to divide this by root 2, because I'm looking at the fundamental wave as a sinusoidal component, so I should be able to divide this by root 2 to get whatever is my fundamental RMS value. Right? Now, if the current is analyzed, it will be the same if I am talking about resistive load. But if I am going to have inductive load, let us try to take a look at the current, what is going to happen. So I said that this is the voltage. Let me redraw the voltage so that we just superpose the current on this itself. So this is going to be the voltage. Right? If I want the current should actually increase as long as I am having a positive excitation, and it should start decreasing as long as I have the negative excitation. So I will have essentially the current increasing, say, somewhat like this. Maybe from a negative value, it will start increasing, and then it will again start decreasing. Again, increasing, decreasing, and so on. This is the way I'm going to have my current, right? Because this will essentially follow Ri plus L di by dt, where R and L are load resistance and inductance, equal to V dc by 2. Right? Assuming that the capacitances are retaining the same VDC by 2 all the time. Assuming that the capacitance is really of a large value, then I should be able to maintain the voltage somewhat constant. Right? Although in actuality, you will see a small amount of difference in the voltages. Right? It will be coming on and off. Although we are actually taking out the energy from this capacitor, whatever is the energy taken out of this capacitor, equal to the energy that is fed by this capacitor as well, because we are keeping them on for 50% each duration for, you know, a complete cycle. So this will be my expression. So I can say I of t will be equal to VDC divided by 2R, which is the steady state value, 1 minus e power minus t by tau, plus whatever is the I initial value multiplied by e power minus t by tau. That is the way it is going to be. Right? That will be the expression for the current. Normally, like a first order differential equation solution, where tau equal to L by R. Right? Now, please note, I'm not going to keep the switch S1 on beyond this point. So, S1 turns off at this point. S1 is off, right, where the arrow ends. I'm going to have essentially S1 turning off at that point, which means I have to provide an alternate path for this positive current to flow. Otherwise, you are going to have a huge LDI by DT that is coming into picture. So normally, what we do is to have a diode which is known as the feedback diode. We'll always have a diode connected in parallel with a transistor or IGBT or FET So if the current is flowing in this direction, I want the current to flow in the same direction. Only thing that can carry the current in the same direction is this diode, not that other diode. So until now C1 was discharging, now C2 will get charged. So there is a good possibility for C2 voltage to rise. Already it was not discharging. Now it is also taking up the energy from the inductive load, because of which you can have a slight rise in the capacitor voltage. And this is what is the major root cause. Initially C1 was discharging. Now C2 is getting charged. So there can be a little difference in the voltage between C1 and C2. Ideally, we do not want this difference. But it is kind of not very easy to eliminate the difference completely. There are several control techniques we adopt to make sure that the two voltages are balanced as much as possible. So normally what you are going to do is to allow another alternate path for the current where D2 is going to take over. So if you actually look at it, during this interval, D2 will take over. Right? And from here to here, although you had tried to turn on S1 right from the beginning, but S1 will turn on only from here, where the current is in the positive direction. You may give the pulses even before that, but S1 will not be able to turn on until D1 is conducting. D1 will be conducting during this portion. So when D1 is conducting, there is no way S1 can turn on. Please note that S1 will be reverse biased when D1 is conducting, because when D1 is conducting, I'm going to have positive here and negative here. And the switch that you connect here will be in this direction. This is how it will be. So you want basically VCE to be positive. That will not happen when the diode is conducting. So D1 will be conducting for this duration and S1 will be conducting for this duration. D2 will be conducting here, S2 will be conducting here, again D1 will be conducting here, and so on and so forth. So the steady state here corresponds to the minimum currents remaining at the same value cycle after cycle. Similarly, maximum currents remaining at the same value cycle after cycle. Rather, half cycle after half cycle. So you are going to have this value to remain the same, and this value will be remaining the same. I minimum and I maximum will remain the same, cycle after cycle. That's what you would see. That is what is known as steady state. There is nothing like a normal DC current which is going to assume a fixed value. That's not going to happen, right? So this particular circuit consists of only two switches and two diodes. And although your input supply is VDC, what you get as the output is only VDC by 2. And when you are having VDC by 2 actually being delivered, if this switch is a short, for example, please note that this positive is connected here. When this switch is not conducting, you are going to have this positive connected here directly, and this is negative here, which means VDC will come across the non-conducting switch. That is twice the voltage of what it can deliver. So half bridge, normally each of the devices will face a stress corresponding to the twice the voltage of whatever it could deliver as output. So you are going to see that if it is delivering VDC by 2, VDC will be the voltage stress or voltage that it has to block whenever it is in off condition. This is one of the problems of half bridge, because if I'm talking about kilovolts level of an inverter, I do not want really to increase the cost of those devices by simply having the rating to be increased twice as compared to what it can deliver. So half bridge is generally used only when I actually am going to use it for smaller rating, not for very large rating. Normally, in larger rating, we hardly ever use half bridge. We will only use full bridge in that case. So let us try to take a look at full bridge VSI. Again, we are talking about single phase. So we are looking at a DC voltage source, and then I'm going to have four switches, which is similar to that of whatever we studied in full bridge DC to DC converter. It's exactly similar. And there will be feedback diodes in these cases also. These diodes are known as feedback diodes because they feed back the energy stored in the load inductance. So these are feedback diodes. So each of them is going to be connected to a feedback diode in anti-parallel. And please note that these diodes have to be fast acting. They can't be power frequency diodes. We talked about two or three different types of diodes. You remember? We talked about power frequency diode. We talked about fast recovery diode and Schottky diode. So fast recovery diodes have to be used in this case because they have to essentially work very quickly. So unless they act very quickly, it's going to be difficult, especially if I'm using in PWM. So that's the reason why what we use will be normally fast recovery diodes. So the load is going to be connected here. So I can name this as S1, S3, S2, and S4. Now, if I am looking at positive half cycle, which is actually going to make the current flow in this direction, S1 and S4 have to be turned on, right? And after S1 and S4 are turned off, if I want the current to flow in the same direction, right? I want the current to flow in the same direction means I'm going to have these two diodes, right? This diode and this diode conducting with the current direction being the same. But please note, it is feeding back the energy to the battery, right? So the battery will get charged. It is like regeneration. So we are going to have the current flowing in the same direction with the diodes feeding back the stored energy of the inductance, load inductance, back to the battery. So let us again try to draw the waveform for, so let us say this is the positive half cycle and this is going to be the negative half cycle and again positive half cycle and so on. So let us say this is V load. Right? Now if I am looking at the current, maybe it is starting from some negative value and then it is reaching the maximum value like this. And again, it is going to be something like this and so on and so forth. This is how the current is going to be. Right? So during this particular duration, I am going to have actually, during this duration, I am going to have S1 and S4 both conducting. Right? That's why the current is also positive. And voltage is also positive, which means the power is flowing from the DC side into the AC side. The power is positive. It is being consumed by the load. When voltage as well as current are positive, it's going to be consumed by the load, right? That's why the current is increasing. Now, during this portion, I'm going to have the current flowing. Let me try to name these things. This is D3 and this is D2. So I'm going to have D2 and D3 conducting during this portion. So the voltage is going to remain, and the voltage is going to become negative because I'm having essentially the positive being connected through the diode here and negative being connected through the diode here. So the voltage has reversed its direction. Originally, when I looked at the voltage, S1 was connecting positive here and S2 was connecting the, S4 was connecting the negative here. Right, whatever I have mentioned in green is when I had S1 and S4 conducting. Once they have gone off, I'm going to have D2 and D3 taking over, which is going to have a negative voltage. Right? And similarly, I'm going to have S2 and S3 conducting here, and I'm going to have D1 and D4 conducting here. If I may call this as D1 and this as D4. So D1 and D4 are going to conduct here. If I try to look at what is the kind of current I'm going to see from the source side. So this is load current. And this is load voltage. Right? So what is the kind of supply side current that is going to come up? So when I am looking at S1 and S4 conducting, right? I'm going to have essentially the current going like this. This is how it is going to be. Whatever is S1 and S4 current, it is going from the supply towards the load, right? Whereas when I am looking at this current, this portion of the current, that is essentially flowing from the load into the supply. So it is in the opposite sense. So I have to show it as though this is essentially coming until here, maybe somewhat like this, right? And again, when S2 and S3 are conducting, I'm going to have the current essentially going like this. And again, I'm going to have the current being fed back to the supply whenever I have the diodes conducting. So this will be the supply current. So this is essentially, if I call this as IS, IS waveform is going to be somewhat like this. I hope you get this. Whenever I'm going to have the devices conducting, I'm having the power flowing from VDC to the load. So it is in positive direction. The current is in the positive direction. And whenever the diodes are conducting, it is actually flowing back from the load to the supply itself. It is trying to replenish the battery. So this is going to be the kind of supply current that we are going to have. So battery is getting charged and discharged alternately in this particular case when I'm going to have RL load. And if I try to look at any of the devices, what it has to block, it will be blocking VDC itself. You can analyze and you can definitely find out that in full bridge converter, they are not going to be rated for more than VDC. That is the way normally our full bridge VSI works. So full bridge VSI is normally employed in all larger power rated circuits. They are very commonly used in many of the larger power rated circuit. But sometimes, if I'm going to have, you know, 20 kilovolt or 30 kilovolt as the overall voltage rating of my circuit, it might be sometimes difficult to just employ a pair of devices. So you might have to employ many of them in series. Rather than that, we sometimes employ something called multi-level inverter. I'm just introducing the terminology. I'm not going to go in depth into this because this is being researched extensively now. So I thought at least I should introduce you to what is a multi-level inverter. So in multi-level inverter, let us say I have one inverter here. Right? So this is one inverter. I can have one more inverter like this. So if each of them is producing, let us say, 250 volts approximately, by connecting them in series, I would be able to produce 500 volts. Right? I would be able to definitely produce larger amount of voltage. And I can also control each of them such that maybe rather than getting a complete square voltage, if one of them is conducting for a longer duration and the other one I make it conduct only for a shorter duration? I can make it closer to a sinusoid. I can have multiple number of steps like this. I can make basically a stepped voltage waveform, which will be emulating somewhat a sinusoid. I'm not saying this is exactly a sinusoid, but I would be able to get closer and closer to the sinusoid provided I have multiple levels of voltage source inverters like this. So now what I can do is, this is one end of the load terminal, so let me take that out. And from here, I can connect it to this. And from here, I can connect to the load. So here, I can connect my load. Right? I'm essentially connecting the two outputs in series. You imagine whatever we did in auto transformer, something similar. What we are doing is essentially connecting one end of the load here, the other end of the load here, and in between we are connecting them in series. That's it. So this will allow me to get twice the voltage of whatever is the voltage that I am applying here and here. But please note, I have drawn two independent voltage sources. I can't connect them also together. Either I need to provide isolation on this side between the two voltage outputs, or I need to provide isolation on the input side. Either on the input or on the output, I need to provide isolation. Otherwise, it will be a dead shot, right? So this is typically used whenever, for example, solar water pumping system, where I may have each of the solar cells having very small value of output. I can connect two solar cells independently to the two inverters, connect them in series, and together I can give it to a motor. That is a possibility, right? So if I have multiple number of this, then I call them as cascaded H-bridge. Each of these full bridge inverter is generally called also as H-bridge configuration. So we call this as cascaded H-bridge multi-level inverter. So each of them can function independently as a single phase inverter, no doubt. So the major advantage I can visualize in this case is, if I have five such inverters connected in series, one of them conk out, I need to essentially have in the inventory multiple number of the single phase inverter. Remove the faulty inverter, put the good inverter. You can do that. So it is like parallel operation of transformer, what we talked about earlier in electromechanics course. We said that rather than using 20 kVA transformer directly, you can use two 10 kVA transformer in parallel. So what backup you store is only 10 kVA, not 20 kVA. So that way, it also reduces the rating of the backup. That is one of the major advantages we have in this cascaded H-bridge multi-level inverter topology. One more thing is that each of these switches need to be rated only for VDC, not 2 VDC. Each of these switches need to be rated only for VDC. There is nothing like you have to rate them for a higher voltage. So that way, it becomes much more comfortable to construct smaller units and then put them together, right? So this is a very upcoming area which is being researched extensively, multi-level inverters, right? Now, let me just go over to the three-phase inverter. After discussing all of them in square wave, then we will go for directly discussing them with different PWM techniques. So three-phase inverters normally are actually constructed in half-bridge fashion. That is, I will not have four devices. Instead, I will have only two devices for every phase. So typically, I'm going to have something like this. This is my VDC. So I'm going to have one switch another switch. This is belonging to A phase. I'm going to have one more switch and one more switch. This belongs to B phase. Then the third leg, which belongs to C phase. And numbering we will do very similar to what we had done for the rectifier. So I will call this as S1, this is S4, this is S3, this is S5, S6, and S2. Of course, each of them will have diodes as well in parallel. They will have diodes as well in parallel, no doubt. And we are going to connect from here the three loads. And I'm going to take star connected load for now. I'm going to leave the delta connected load to be analyzed by you guys. You guys would do it. Okay? So I'm going to do it for star connected load. So this is one load, this is the second load, and this is the third load. So let me call this as ZB and ZA. Because S1 and S4, I want to take it for A phase. Right? There are two modes of conduction. Normally we analyze in a square wave inverter for three-phase case. Each of the devices can conduct for 120 degree. Or each of the devices can conduct for 180 degree. Either way is fine. So we call one of them as 120 degree conduction mode. The other one as 180 degree conduction mode. These are the two types of conduction which we would be analyzing. So let us say we are talking about 120 degree conduction mode to start with. So first of all, let me draw the A phase, B phase and C phase voltages, right? Then we have to draw the line to line voltages as well, because we would like to definitely know how the line voltages are. Always the load need not be star connected, but nevertheless we should analyze for both star as well as delta configuration, because the loads could be connected in either way. But in either case, we should know what is the load voltage as well as the phase voltage as well as line voltages. So if this is the way it is, and let us say I'm going to have probably, let me call this as the 180 degree point, this is 360. So this is 0, this is 180 degree, this is 360 degrees. Okay? And then I'm also drawing 60 degree intervals like this. So I'm going to have, in all probability, let us say, one is going to conduct for some time, like this. Okay? So if one is conducting like this, and we are talking about 120 degree conduction. So obviously, three has to start conducting from here. From here until this point. This is how it will be. And I'm going to have five conducting from this point until here. Right? They are all 120 degrees shifted from each other. Right? This is how it is going to be. So, when I am having 120 degree conduction mode, I will have in all probability 1 and 6 overlapping with each other. I definitely need an overlap. Otherwise, I'm not going to have the return path for the current. So I will have essentially the current going from S1 through ZA and returning through ZB through S6 back to the negative side. So what I get as the voltage overall, what I get will be essentially VDC across whatever is my 1 and 6. So that is VAB. That is going to be VDC value itself. So I am essentially going to have this, let us say, along with this. So this is S1. This is S1. So along with this, I have to have S6 conducting. Right? Clearly, I have to have S6 conducting. And under this condition, so if S6 is conducting here, S6 must have conducted here also for 60 degrees, clearly. And I should have a 60 degree dead band here, like what we had in the case of rectifier without commutation overlap. I'm essentially drawing the pulses rather than drawing VA, VB, VC. I should say, first of all, I'm drawing the pulses. So when I draw the pulses, I'm essentially going to have the pulses that are delivered to any of the devices somewhat like this, right? So when S1 is conducting, it is this way. This is S3. And along with S3, initially S2 will be conducting. So I should show from here, I will have S2 conducting for 260 degree duration. Right? And then I'm going to have for these two also, this is S6, S4, I'm yet to draw S4. So from here it will start and it will go through this. This is going to be S4. Right? So when I am having the voltages, the pulses, so this is pulses to A, pulses to A phase devices, and this is pulses to B phase devices, and this is pulses to C phase. Right? So if I try to look at actually what is the value of the voltage during this particular time. With respect to neutral, I have to see what is the voltage across each of the loads, right? That is what will give me exactly whatever is the phase voltage of the load. We are looking at the phase voltage of the load. So if I am looking at the phase voltage of the load, when S1 is conducting, I am going to have S1 and S6 are conducting, I am going to have VAB is equal to VDC when 1 and 6 are conducting, right? So I'm going to have VAN equal to VDC by 2, VBN equal to minus VDC by 2, because I'm assuming that it is all balanced load, completely balanced load. That's how it is going to be. So I should be able to say that whatever are the pulses I have got, exactly, they are the magnitude of voltages also across the load phase. But only thing is, it is each of it is VDC by 2, not VDC itself. It is going to be VDC by 2. So I'm going to have VDC by 2. This is also going to be equal to VDC by 2, each of them. Right? So whatever I have got, I should be able to directly draw them as the phase voltages, right? How will you get now line to line voltages? That's what you have to check. So we have said VAB equal to VDC, agreed, but we can also get what is the line to line voltages by subtracting VAN minus whatever is my VBN directly. So if I have actually, if I want, in this particular case, this is VDC by 2 minus VDC by 2. So it is VDC minus minus VDC by 2. So this is VDC. So let me write VAB, or shall we draw it here itself so that the time scale is exactly the same. So VAB is going to be VDC during this portion. Right? What is going to be the next value of voltage? Here I'm having 0 volts as VB, whereas here it is going to be VDC by 2. So I will have, during this portion, I will have VDC by 2 as the voltage. So this is VDC, whereas this is VDC by 2. Please note that this is going to be my line to line voltage. Right? After that, I'm going to have S3, which is actually VDC by 2. Just a second. Is this correct? Yes. So this is VDC by 2. So I am going to have minus VDC by 2 here for another 60 degree duration. So this is going to be minus VDC by 2. After that, I'm going to have this and 4, both of them conducting. So I'm going to have minus VDC by 2, minus VDC by 2. So that will be minus VDC. So I'm going to have a voltage like this, which is actually VDC. Then this is going to be just minus VDC by 2 itself. So essentially my waveform will be somewhat like this. I am having first VDC, then VDC by 2, then minus VDC by 2, then VDC, then again this, and so on. This is going to repeat itself. So each of them is VDC and VDC by 2. Please note, what we applied was just VDC, but we are essentially getting two levels of voltage on the positive side and two levels of voltage in the negative side as well, as far as the line-to-line voltage is concerned. If I look at the line-to-line voltage, it is going to oscillate between VDC by 2 and VDC every time in the positive side as well as negative side. So similarly, you should be able to draw what is VBC and VCA and so on. All of them will be displaced from each other by 120 degrees at the fundamental frequency, whatever is my frequency that I have chosen to turn on and turn off. Right? Now, this is for 120 degree conduction mode. What we analyzed now was 120 degree conduction mode. So in 120 degree conduction mode, what I look at is the load phase voltage that will be having either VDC level, VDC by 2 level or 0 level. We don't have anything in between, whereas the line to line voltages are going to have 3 levels basically. And there is no 0 voltage interval at all in any of the load voltages in the line to line. So if I look at the 180 degree conduction mode, so let us again take the same inverter. Yeah. Three stages are because if I am not having any voltage at all in B, so whatever is my A phase voltage that is returning through the third phase, not through B. It is returning through C phase. So B phase is not at all involved. There is no current through B phase. So B phase is dead. So if I want to look at what is VAB, I have to essentially subtract VBN from VAN. VBN is zero. So VAN, whatever is the value, which is VDC by 2, that is coming up. Right? Yeah, but minus VDC by 2 is also there. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4. You will not have any 0 at all in this case. There is no 0. That's what I said. There is nothing like a dead band, a complete 0. That is not existing in the line-to-line voltage in 120 degree conduction mode. Right? And we are analyzing it with respect to R load. Because if we involve RL load, the complications would multiply. Because the diodes will get into conduction, and it is very difficult to say, you know, how long the diode is going to conduct. So you may have the three phases involvement. All those things will get into picture. So it's not easy to analyze an inverter with RL load, especially in three phase, especially in 120 degree conduction mode. Because we're assuming that that phase should stop right there. And it is not going to stop. We know. That's the reason. Right? So in 180 degree conduction mode, this is S1, this is S4, S3, S6, S5, and S2. And we are going to have A phase, B phase, and C phase star connected. Again, I'm taking star connected loads. Okay? delta and star normally would be a dual of each other. So please draw the waveform corresponding to delta a little later for 120 as well as 180. You would see that the phase voltages and line voltages reverse their roles, actually in terms of the shape, what you get. So let us try to take a look at 180 degree conduction mode. So this is ZC, this is ZB, and this is ZA, and this is the neutral, and this is VDC, right? If each device has to conduct for 180 degrees, clearly I have to have 1, 2, 3 conducting for 60 degrees. 2, 3, 4 conducting for the next 60 degrees. 3, 4, 5 and so on and so forth. So every device will conduct for 60 plus 60 plus 60, 180 degrees. So you will have three devices overlapping together, right? So I'm going to have 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 4, 3, 4, 5, 4, 5, 6, 5, 6, 1, 6, 1, 2. These are going to be the combinations that I will have. So whenever I'm going to have, let us say, for example, 1, 2, and 3, you have to imagine something similar to what we did in commutation overlap. So 1 and 3 both are on the positive side, whereas 2 is on the negative side. So I will have it as though this is my VDC, what I'm applying, and this is 1 and this is 3. Right? So let us say this is 1 and this is 3. And through 1, I'm going to connect ZA. And through 3, I'm going to connect ZB. Now these two are together. And from here, I'm going to have ZC, which is connected to the negative through 2. Right? This is the equivalent circuit that I'm going to have for the inverter. During 1, 2 and 3 conducting, this is how it is going to be. Please note that these two are in parallel. So obviously whatever is the current that I am going to get, that has to be divided into two halves. So the voltage drop that happens here will be half of the voltage drop of this. Together they have to make up for VDC. So obviously this will be 2 by 3 VDC, that will be 1 by 3 VDC. Right? So I'm going to have the voltage drop here to be 2 by 3 VDC, whereas the voltage drop here to be VDC by 3. And this is my neutral. You get my point? That's how you are going to have the voltage drop. So if I try to draw what is the voltage waveform corresponding to this particular interval, right? So let me probably again divide this into two 180 degree interval and 60, 60 and so on, right? So I'm going to have actually, let me try to draw what is VAN. So VAN during this particular duration is going to be plus VDC by 3. So it is going to be plus VDC by 3, right? After this, I'm going to have 2, 3, 4. And please note 4 is also corresponding to A phase. And 2 and 4, both of them are conducting parallelly. So they will have minus VDC by 3 across each of them. So 2 corresponds to C phase, 4 corresponds to A phase, and it will be minus VDC by 3. So I should have from here, it will jump to minus VDC by 3. This is 4 conducting. And here it is going to be 1, 2, 3 conducting. So along with 4, it is 2 and 3. They are conducting. Now when 2, 3, 4, the next one is 3, 4, 5. And 4 is the only negative side device conducting. So that will be minus 2 by 3 VDC. So I will have minus 2 by 3 VDC coming up. So this is minus 2 by 3 VDC. This will be 3, 4, 5. Right? So like this, we should be able to definitely infer 4, 5, 6 and so on and so forth. So this is going to be 4, 5, 6. Then I'm going to have 5, 6, 1. Then 6, 1, 2. And then 1, 2, 3 again. Right? So you can see again that phase voltage in this particular case has basically plus VDC, plus 2 by 3 VDC, then minus 2 by 3 VDC, plus VDC by 3 and minus VDC by 3. So you have basically four different levels that are coming up in this phase voltage as compared to what we got in the other 120 degree conduction. Right? So we should be able to draw similarly. So if this is the way it is as far as A phase is, VA is concerned, VB should be essentially 120 degree shifted. So this is 120, so I should have something like this, I suppose. Something like this, I suppose. Right? And then this should be somewhat like this. So this is VB, VBN. This is VBN. 120 degree shifted beyond whatever is your VAN. So I have just taken this point and I have shifted it by 120 degrees. That's all. That's what I have done. Right? I'm sure when you analyze, you will get it this way. It should come this way. Otherwise, we have done something wrong with the analysis. So how will you get now line to line voltage? Let's say this is VBN. So if I want VAB, let's try to get VAB. So this is A and this is B. This is also VDC by 3 and this is also plus VDC by 3. So during this duration, I'm going to have essentially zero voltage. Right? We have zero voltage. After that, I have minus 2 by 3 VDC and this is plus 2 by 3 VDC. So 2 by 3, minus 2 by 3, minus 2 by 3. Minus 4 by 3 VDC we'll get. Isn't it? I hope this will be minus 4 by 3 VDC, I suppose. Hey. Wait. Minus VDC. Because this is minus VDC by 3, minus 2 by 3 VDC. This is VDC itself. This is VDC itself. After this, this is 2 by 3 VDC, minus 2 by 3 VDC, and this is VDC by 3. Yeah, so this is again minus VDC by, minus VDC itself. So I will have one more minus VDC. This interval will also be minus VDC. Then I will have here this value and this value are coinciding with each other. So I will have zero voltage. I hope so that this will be something like this, plus VDC and plus VDC. Just by, you know, half-wave symmetry I'm drawing it. That's all. Please note that compared to the previous case, this has exactly been opposite. Like there, the line-to-line voltage, what we got was the three-stepped or six-stepped waveform, whereas this was, you know, a square wave. The phase voltage was a square wave. Here it is exactly vice versa. That's all is the difference. When you analyze delta, you have to be a little careful. There is no neutral. So what you are getting as the voltage across each of the phase loads will also be line voltage. So that will be in all probability equal to VDC itself. So you have to be a little careful. You get my point. I'm trying to say that if this load, whatever is connected, is in delta, right? This is 1, this is 2, and this is 3. Each of them is going to be connected to the terminals, that is the mesh point. So we are going to have, let us say this is A, this is B, and this is C. So this will be VAB with the voltage rising in this direction, right? And so on and so forth. That's how it is going to be. So this point as well as this point, for example, will be connected to the DC link if I am having, say, one of these switches and one of these switches conduct. So I will have essentially VDC directly coming across any of the phase loads. So the phase voltages will come out to be VDC every time when the appropriate switches are on. So please make sure that you take the switches correctly and ABC you number in this way, like name in this way, and then make sure that you draw VAB, VBC and VCA. What you are drawing is line to line. The line to line voltages, which are happening to be the phase voltages as well, because it is delta, right? So please draw that and check it out whether you are able to, and for 120 degree as well as 180 degree conduction mode, please try to draw those and then see what can be, you know, the output voltage, right? Now, so far, whatever we have seen, whether it is three phase or single phase, all of them essentially are having the output as a function of VDC, right? Either VDC by 3 or 2 VDC by 3 or whatever. And we don't have any control over the magnitude of any of these voltages because we are keeping the switch on for entire 120 degree or entire 180 degree, whatever be the case. So if I am having a fixed value of DC voltage, I will also have a fixed value of output voltage. Only the frequency I will have controlled. I will not have any control over the magnitude of output voltage. That is one problem. Second problem is all the waveforms that we have got, all these things are far from being sinusoidal. They are not sinusoidal. And if I have to adjust, you know, a motor drive to a particular frequency and then I want it to run very exactly at that particular speed without any torque pulsations and so on and so forth, I definitely need to make sure that the voltages are somewhat close to sinusoid. I may not be able to get exact sinusoid, but I may be able to get it close to a sinusoid by eliminating at least some harmonics. So for these two purposes, that is, one is to adjust the magnitude of output voltage because input is also fixed. I am having a stiff voltage source, which means my input is fixed. With fixed value of input voltage, I want to have a variable value of output voltage. Sure. So we are essentially looking at, first of all, magnitude being controlled. The second one is to eliminate harmonics, rather to make the fundamental dominate the output. These are the major purposes of PWM control. So pulse width modulation control is generally employed in voltage source inverters to fulfill these two requirements, basically, which are mainly meant for motor drives, because motor drives are the ones which are probably going to require variable value of voltage and variable value of frequency as well as elimination of harmonics. So in this case, first of all, the simplest thing to modify the magnitude will be, rather than having the complete 180 degree, what we had as the voltage, let me try to have it only for, let us say, part of the duration. And I would like to symmetrically place it. What I mean is, if I call this angle as alpha, I would like this angle also to be alpha. And here is my 180 degrees. So this will be 180 plus alpha, and this will be 360 minus alpha. So I should try to place the pulse in such a way that it is symmetrically placed whenever I look at any half cycle as such. And the other half cycle is exactly symmetrical as compared to the previous one. This will ensure that I am not going to have, excuse me, first of all, DC component. And also, my fundamental will not be shifted with respect to the original square wave I have taken. So if I try to draw the fundamental corresponding to this, maybe I will have it somewhat like this, much less in terms of magnitude, agreed. But it will not be displaced from the original zero crossing of my square wave. So this is known as single pulse width modulation. We have only one single pulse corresponding to positive half cycle, one single pulse corresponding to negative half cycle, and they are essentially, you know, adjusted. Both these pulses are adjusted. So this is essentially single pulse width modulation. This will not have much of impact on the harmonic content. I may not be able to eliminate the harmonics because I'm not really making the pulse width vary as per the sinusoidal magnitude. I'm having only one pulse, and that maximum pulse is near the 90 degree point, and it is spread out completely. So this will not allow me to eliminate the harmonics much. I may be able to get multiple pulse width modulation, but I'm going to have, in this case, the first one I'm discussing is equal width. I'm not really modulating the width of this pulse as per the magnitude of the or amplitude of the sine wave at that point in time. So I may be able to get, say, one pulse, then second pulse, then third pulse, fourth pulse. Similarly, I may have one pulse, second pulse, third pulse, and fourth pulse. All of them are of equal width. It doesn't serve any other purpose again other than adjusting the magnitude. I may turn it on and turn it off several times. So I have maybe multiple number of angles that I can adjust so that I will be able to adjust the magnitude of the output. So I may call this as alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha 4. Then I can say this is 180 minus alpha 4, 180 minus alpha 3, 180 minus alpha 2, 180 minus alpha 1. On the other side, it will be 180 plus alpha 1, 180 plus alpha 2, and so on. So I can make them essentially symmetrical. That is possible. So this will give me probably multiple variables to be adjusted so that I arrive at a particular magnitude. That's it. Nothing more than that. So this is also not good for eliminating the harmonics. But rather than that, the final one what we will be concentrating upon is sinusoidal pulse width modulation technique. Right? So this is essentially derived from by having a sinusoidal wave which I want to arrive at, and I'm going to compare that with a very high frequency sine wave, triangular wave. I have shown it here as though it is only having a frequency of 1, 2, 3, 4, about 5. 5 times, not even 5 times, less than that. 4.5 times or something. So if I have a larger frequency triangular wave compared with that of a sine wave, I compare the two, wherever the sine wave is having a higher magnitude, I will have a positive pulse. Wherever the sine wave is having a lower magnitude than the triangular wave, I'll have a negative pulse. So I'm going to essentially fire the positive devices, S1 and S4 during the positive pulse, and S2 and S3 during the negative pulse. So this is essentially the basic operation of a sinusoidal PWM. So we will look at sinusoidal PWM in the next class. By the way, coming Thursday, I will not be available. So no class on that day, but Saturday is working on Thursday timetable. So we'll definitely meet on Saturday. In fact, if you guys can give me on that day itself another 1 hour, 1.5 hours sometime, I would definitely like to compensate for whatever we are losing on Thursday. I'm not here on Thursday. Okay? Please let me know. I'll probably talk to a couple of people. Siddesh, will you be able to find out and let me know? And Tanai. Please coordinate among yourselves. Please let me know whether Saturday you will be able to give me some time.